Good morning, it's the 3rd of March 2017, Friday, and it is, for those who want to be pedantic, it's 10:02 a.m. on my computer, and it's 10 o'clock on my watch, so let them both fight about it, have a big chess match against it. Anyway, here is the next game, not with my friend, our match game, which can come after this, but this is our game for the morning. This player, White, is one of my best friends, definitely one of my best friends in chess, which attracts friends and people that I don't get on with, but generally I get on with people. There's some people that probably just don't know what to do when it comes to me, I suppose. I don't know. But this guy has been my friend since I've been about... I've been friends with this guy, Andrew, I'll say. I won't mention his last name, even though he said I can. This guy, we've been friends together since Otago Chess Club days. So anyway, here is this game. Now this game features the opening that Nigel Short, I learnt off Grandmaster Nigel Short, not personally but via Chess Informator, that Nigel Short plays on move 6, basically, kind of f5, but he doesn't play f5, he plays f6, in the Tarrash French, it is. So anyway, without further ado, and this game was played around 3 Cleland Trophy Swiss Tournament Dunedin. The time control was 40 moves in 1.5 hours and 15 minutes on top for the rest of the game. So here we have Andrew, my great, great friend. And this player is no mug. Andrew is no mug because he has, I said I can mention his name. So I'll say Andrew McIntosh, and he's a fine player. He played with me in the Lightning Tournament in the New Zealand Champs, and so we go a long way back, and sadly I beat him in that Lightning game, but anyway, at New Zealand, so Wellington. So anyway, here we go, this is the game. So the move isn't my move, okay, move 6 is not my move. And here we go here, e4, e6. So here's the French, and I've been quite happy to play the French for a long, long time. And so it's probably not a good idea for my opponents to know that Weegenaar plays the French. But another player says, from Otago, he says, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So f6 here is a move that was introduced into master play and that sort of thing by himself as well, by Grandmaster Nigel Short, who was about second in the world back then, because this game was played 30th of November, sorry, I forgot to say that, 30th of November 1983. So around about this time, Nigel Short was second or third in the world, and Karpov and Kasparov and Korchnoi were around, but I recall that Nigel Short was, I believe, the challenger for the World Cup against the great Garry Kasparov. Now this is a typical move from White and the French in this variation. And so black plays queen f7 and bishop d3. Now, one other thing I want to say is that my friend Andrew McIntosh, I know that he beat the later to become New Zealand champion of chess, who is, I believe, an international master. He beat him in the New Zealand School Pupil Championships, because they were the only representatives from Dunedin at their age, and he's 1 year older than the then New Zealand champion that was, he was later on an international master, I believe, at least, and that's the thing. But he was I forgot my thread, but anyway, he was beaten this player back then in the New Zealand School Pupil Championships. Yes, it was. And the other player than Andrew was a little bit scrawny after the game. He said something to Andrew that Andrew doesn't forget, and he thinks it's quite funny. It was sort of an idea of, I want to do something for you beating me here. And I've had that sort of thing too. I've beaten some great players in tournaments where everyone's watching. And like New Zealand reserve champs, I beat an Otago champion. Because there's a lot of chess players that are champions, you know. Now this is just threatening this winning material, but at the expense of opening up white's position to get play on this file with the rooks and other means. So white plays castles long here, Andrew does, and I go rook takes knight, which if pawn takes, then queen takes bishop check, and then probably queen back here, or h6 to prevent bishop takes pawn. Oops, I'm sorry, it's not meant to happen. I hope that didn't muck the game up. Oh no, it did. Oh, it was the move. It was the move, that's right. Rook f3, bishop h7, and I just take this now. So I'm winning material, and Andrew's got a pawn out of it. And he retains his black squared bishop. But anyway, I was saying, I had beaten in the reserve, in the New Zealand reserve, or the major open of New Zealand championships, which is the second group of chess players in the New Zealand championships, a long time ago. I beat a top player from Otago, and he was very annoyed with me. It was a Grunfeld, which is very popular with people like Garry Kasparov, or was. It's d4, knight f6, c4, g6, knight c3, d5. That's the Grunfeld defense. As white, I beat him in a fine game. And he was really, really annoyed, because normally he would just beat me. So anyway, but when it came to this tournament, he lost. And this is the same sort of disagreement that Andrew here had with that player from New Zealand a long time ago, which is all history now. They've both grown up since schoolboy days. Which is sad and good at the same time. I played bishop f8, I couldn't figure it out what I played, and so I'm playing bishop f5, so my normal aggressive stuff. Now, I take this pawn now, and the thing is, it's probably no good if I play g6, because then he's got this iron clasped pawn on h6, isn't he? And so that could be quite good for white, because I forever have to watch it or take it or something like that, but it's very, very hard to win it. I can win it, but it just becomes hard. So I take it, and he plays rook h4, which is wanting to play rook here. Now, Andrew is a very fine tactical player and all that sort of thing. Now, what say I go king here? What say you if I go king here? Well, that's not entirely a bad move, but white just merely has at least this move checked with the rook. And then I have to go somewhere, and so it's not that great. So that's not what I played. He played rook h4. Now, he's now threatening this. No, he's not, because it's check, isn't it? So I thought he's threatening this now with rook, bishop takes to follow, and then rook here. But he can't, because it's check first, and that would allow me time to go rook here and rook here to defend my bishop twice. So here he plays rook h4, and I merely play rook e8. And knight c5 happens, e4. Now I go on a pawn munching session. Rook g h1, of course, nothing wrong with that move. I take this, he takes with the bishop, and I do a kind of an intermezzo move. We've already discussed what an intermezzo move is, so I play a couple of intermezzo moves here. I play the pawn, takes the pawn, cb2, check. Then he plays king b2, and I play knight c4. Now, I think that white can play rook c4 now. Okay, can play it. Okay, can play it. But I merely play, do I? Actually, I'm just looking at this right now, and I'm thinking that Andrew missed this move. So this is my improvement, I think, without going into it too much. I think that Andrew can play rook c4 here. Did I write that down? And why can he play that? Because if I play here, then white takes this bishop with check. And then what happens is I have to move my king. Can't do anything else. So I have to move my king somewhere. So I'll probably go king g8. And then the bishop comes back here, and even though I've got a very strong pawn and everything like that, this is a little, you know, at least better for white than what happened. But anyway, this is what I would play here, and black would laugh if white played king c3, because this is checkmate. So we can't do that for my friend, but he's in my best friends list. Andrew is He's all the thing is about a good friend is they end up always being there, and they don't necessarily judge one, and they don't sort of like, yeah, so they don't sort of judge, and you don't sort of, I don't experience with Andrew a telling off for anything. I can't remember a telling off at all from him at all. And I'm not sure how he felt after this game. But anyway, here, I can't do this, of course. If it was my move, because Andrew would have, this move, which might be good, might not be. I'm not even sure if it is, but it's not that great. But I'm just digressing there. So we've got King B2, Knight C4. Now I consider Rook C4 an improvement, but White does need to be careful and is going to lose some pawns because of Rook C4. Bishop H6, what else? I can go DC4, which I did. So if I go Bishop H6, then White merely plays Rook C, this one, to H4, and I can't go Rook E6 to defend the bishop, as I said before, because White takes my rook with the knight, and then after the bishop with the rook on h4, and then the bishop on e6, and it's looking pretty dim. So rook c4, even though it's not great for White, because they are going to end up a pawn down. I'd have to take this. Bishop takes here, king here, bishop here, rook check. Now, not the king here, so maybe the king here, but then we've got this very strong move which threatens a rook a2 checkmate. So it's difficult for White, don't get it wrong, but it's better than what happened. So White would have to relinquish pawns here, but can gobble up Black's pawns if they're so allowed. New variation. Now, if this was the game, I'd play this for Black, and this is quite powerful. Or I would play this. And that's merely threatening Rook A1 check. And Rook takes H1, and if the Rook checks here to get out of the way, which it's not really doing it, is it? I would play King here, and Black has a totally won game, because White has to move the bishop, now attacked, and the bishop, once the bishop moves, regardless, the white rook on g1 is lost to rook a1. So that's no good for White, this move now. And the bishop can go here. Sorry, bishop can go here. Then I'd go, would I? So that'd be alright. White would just lose this pawn, and they have to look after this pawn here, something. So that's some sort of like crazy analysis that favours Black. So Black's got basically a one position. So we'll go back to the main line. King c3 after knight c4. No, that's not the one I want. Bishop g7, a wee bit cheeky. Bishop g7, relieving my my opponent's hold of trying to get a discovered check on me and winning pieces and things like that from that black squared bishop. So it doesn't force a capture, or does it? So the only move for white here, other than bishop takes g7, is king here. And then I can play around with the king a wee bit, not too much. The white king can come here. I've got to be careful for bishops moving away somewhere and attacking a devastating spot. So I have to be a wee bit careful. I can't be careless. Or I can't go all tactical here, which I tend to do. Bishop g7, king g7, rook g1, king f7, not f6 or h8. I mean f8. Not here or here, because it provokes checks, but just king here. So white can't play this rook check here, of course, because the bishop takes h7. So he plays rook g5, my young, wonderful friend, and I play knight d6 now. Knight b7, fair enough. If I take this, then he wins a pawn at least back, and it's very important, a pawn. Now I play, before thinking about taking this knight, I just play d4. Now, what does black have to meet now? What does white do now? King d2, then I go king f6. Thereby, I'm now attacking his rook. He could go knight d6 here now, which is attacking my rook and getting his knight out of trouble, but his rook's attacked too. So if he goes knight takes d6, I go king g5, and if knight e8, king h4, and then I've got knight c7, and I can sort of play my knight here. I can show you all this. So this is here. f4, king f6, f4, and I go knight e4, and my opponent Andrew resigned, because he's going to lose his rook for my stallion steed, and he has to be careful anyway, because he can't go here or here. He can only go here or here, because if he goes here, it's knight check with, I mean, it's knight takes g5, and at the same time it's check with the bishop to the white king, so I win the rook for nothing. And now white would have to go here, can't go here because I won the other knight rook. Anyway, so that's that. So now I just want to show you here, instead of f4, this analysis, okay? can't go here because of what? And you'll be surprised, my friends, and that miss these sorts of moves in lightning chess particularly, or they'll play a longer game and they'll play another move and then they'll change their move to the move that I'm wanting to show you, which I'm not going to want to play myself or train myself to play. But anyway, here I wouldn't play this move anyway because it fails to f4 check, but it's still probably a win. It's still probably a win for black. Here I would play merely this move here, check and then d2, because the king can't come to here. It can't take the pawn, of course, so it has to move here, which is almost stalemating my king. It has to move here or here. It can't move anywhere else, and it's a check with the knight, so it has to move, either take the knight or move out of check from the knight. And once the pawn king moves out of the flow for the pawn merely moves and it's end of the game a few times over. So that's what I would play. But here, if this, then we got f4, and I'm saying that this is still probably a win for white, for black. And here's not a good move, because black gets to start attacking the knight and then can save their piece, because the knight can only check here and the black king would not be advised to go here because of knight b5 check and etc. But here, where the knight can't take, and this can take here, bomb here to deflect the bishop. Now the bishop would not want to take this pawn here, because all of a sudden white would have a draw, because this is the only pawn that black's got left, and this is the 8th rank position for this pawn. Unless it got to take the B pawn, if it became able to take something on B3 or something to change the queening square to a white square, but it can't. It's impossible in this position. So black needs to defend that pawn, which is protected past by the bishop, and merely play king here, but not bishop takes here. I'll show you why, and then I think that will be the end of the session. White can play this, 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 this. No, we're just being silly here. This, 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 this. This, 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 this. I'm not saying you can't try to win it. In fact, whoever you're playing, give it a go. This, 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 not this, because of stalemate. So you've got to be careful. But if white was stupid enough to go in here, which I have just done for white, black would have this move, thereby this is a win now, because the king is out of place to the enemy pawn now advancing without any success from white to be able to prevent its imminent and infamous A1 queening or rook or bishop. And then you can show the bishops. But anyway, So here, white would be mistaken and lost after this move, and drawn if black plays this move. So white would have to, black would have to go here. Now if this move, this would be silly because of this move and threatening here. And if here, then black commands this square here, and eventually a king can come here, and a bishop can come to b3, and then the pawn just marches. So if the black white king comes here, then the black king comes here, and it's all over. And I can show you how or why. So here it's no good for white to get their king in this position. It's best to go here, because white wants to be in front of this pawn here, not behind it, because if they're behind it, the pawn runs. And that's sort of not behind it either. It's sort of neither there or here or anywhere. So in this position here, it's a draw. We'll say we go here, okay? And I'm not going to say I'm going to play this Grandmaster strength, because they've got these things all sussed, these guys. But as you can see, I'm wanting to get my king in front of the pawn and not have the pawn sort of adjacent or in front of my king, unless I can get it to a certain position. Black is now met with king a1 or something like that. King here, king here, and now bishop here is no good because white goes here and threatens stalemate. So if white is met with king b3, it's stalemate, which is pretty hard to meet. So white can attempt, black can attempt to keep pushing, okay? Now what does black do to advance? You tell me. Okay, doesn't go there. And we can play this for black, because if king takes bishop, then pawn queens. And that would be a8 for black. Pawn to a8, queen. Okay, a8 equals queen, as it said. And it's not check, but it would soon be checkmate after that. So white merely plays here. Now notice black can't go here to this square or this square. So white is not threatened with an advance to their position. And whereas if this was a black squared bishop, then white would be lost, but not in this position. White would be lost because the pawn wouldn't be here, of course. The pawn would be on a3, and the bishop would be defending it. And because I can show you that, I'll just show you that. Why not? And then that's got to be the end of the session. Okay. And we're going to say anyone can move here. So here we've got now the queening square is owned by the black squared bishop, but the king can't, as we've just seen, the king can't force its hand here unless white makes a mistake or is out of scope, where the bishop is of the wrong colour for the rook pawn to promote. Against best play, and that the king can interpolate the enemy advancing pawn, it's against best play, there may be exceptions, it's a draw every time. But I'm not saying that if you play someone and you've got a bishop and a pawn and it's the wrong coloured pawn, rook pawn, rook 8 square or a8, h8 or h1 or a1 square, whether you're black or white, I'm not saying that your opponent might not mistakenly resign. You know, I'll give you a real quick one here. Now, if white goes here, we've got a cute move, and lots of people set, some people don't. Well, here is stalemate, isn't it? Okay, here is stalemate, okay? Here is stalemate, okay? Oh, it's not letting me move. Here is stalemate, okay? Here is stalemate, okay? Here is stalemate. You get the point, don't you? It's stalemate if black doesn't make a sensible move. Here is checkmate, okay? That's checkmate. That's the end of the session. I've enjoyed showing you my one of my best friends of all my life, Andrew McIntosh's game with him. And I'd like it if he drew with me or something like that, but back then I probably wouldn't have, but now I would be rapt to show him drawing or beating me, okay? And that's my honest truth. But anyway, that's the end of the session. So it's 10:40 a.m. now in New Zealand, and that's the end of the session. I hope you enjoyed today's game. Tomorrow I endeavour to play the third game with my other friend that I've shown a match game that we had a match together, and that ended up with me 3 out of 3. Thank you, bye. The David Weegenaar is the channel name, WEEGENAAR, and I would love to see new subscribers. Thank you.